So I need somebody to transition us. I came to lecture. So I put a lot of work into this lecture here. When I saw that Dr. McIntosh would be here, Dr. JJ, these are former colleagues. I succeeded Dr. McIntosh at the Ministry of Planning. He's the person who designed the poverty reduction strategy before he joined the bank as executive director. And I came and coordinated the implementation. So Doc, it's good to see you here, the two of you. And I'm glad that it seems like I keep following Dr. McIntosh. Yeah? So from planning, I went there. From the World Bank, I went to the World Bank. Now we are at Cuttington. Maybe I'll teach here someday. Indos Jobaka. So I'm following you, Doc. No, but I have a lot of respect for these two men. Thank you very much. All right, so the way we'll do this, I will try my best to go through these slides. It's about 50 slides. They asked me to talk about, I take this seriously. I wanted to come and share and also learn from you. So I put a lot of work into this when Dr. Sumaworo contacted me. Thank you for inviting me. I've been up since 2 working on this. So let's learn from each other, all right? Yeah. Okay, good. So they asked me to talk about the World Bank, the African Development Bank. It would just take about 15 minutes to do that. But this is an hour and a half class. It's a 3-credit course, is that what it is?
Yes.
Uh-huh. So I wanted to give you something good for the full time so that you can get some credit, I hope. So today we'll talk about Liberia and multilateralism. We'll bring in a little bit of the bilateral relationships there because official development assistance is multilateral aid versus bilateral aid, right? Multilateralism, we're talking about the World Bank, the African Development Bank, the IMF, and so on and so forth. Bilateral relationships, we're talking about countries. The US, the EU representing several countries, Germany, Sweden, you'll see all their figures here. And then we'll show you some stylized facts to show correlations between income and growth. So we'll start with the rich countries and then the poorest countries. Then we'll try to understand why some countries are richer and some countries are poorer. So you can connect the dots. Then we'll come to multilateralism. Then I will show you the history of Liberian multilateralism, how much money we've brought here, and then we can decide whether it's been working or not. Then I can share with you the rationale of foreign aid and the budget issue, the financing issues, based on my experience as Minister of Finance and also working with the bank for 6.5 years. And then we'll look at this guy called Marcus, you know, this old economist, developing model, where he talks about population and food and totality, and then we'll see if we are still stuck in that. This was in the 1800. So maybe we are still stuck in the 1800 economic stuff. We can debate that. All right? So, go ahead. Okay, no, go back. There you go. So this is the outline of our lecture today. We'll talk about, income inequality. Like I said, we'll show you some of the rich countries. You'll see it, and then we'll show you some correlates of income, some of the things that really drive countries' income that we should focus on. And then we'll look at the multilateralism, the main reason why I'm here, which is ODA, Official Development Assistance. Then I'll also share with you, as a bonus, Liberia's long-term history of growth from 1960 to the present. And then you will see how things are for our country and some implications. Okay, it's dark. I tried to get a good one. But these are the 25 richest countries in the world. Luxembourg is the richest country in the world, more than the United States. I think US, what, 5? Number 5 on our list?
7.
So there are countries that are richer than the US in the world, believe it or not. But the US is still powerful, right? So you can just go through the 25 quickly for the class.
Luxembourg, Ireland, Switzerland, Qatar, Norway, Singapore, US, Iceland, Australia, Denmark, Sweden, Canada, Israel, Netherlands, Monaco, Austria, Hong Kong, UK, Finland, Belgium, Germany, New Zealand, UAE, San Marino, France.
There you go. Your 25 wealthiest countries in the world. Next. The 25 poorest countries in the world.
Burundi, Sierra Leone, Malawi, Central African Republic, Madagascar, Somalia, South Sudan, Niger, Mozambique, Eritrea, DRC, Chad, Liberia, Burkina Faso, Yemen, Guinea-Bissau, Mali, the Gambia, Sudan, Rwanda, Togo, Tajikistan, Uganda, Myanmar, Lesotho.
So maybe two or three countries not in Africa. So, three. Yes. The rest of the 25, 22 of the world poorest countries are in Africa. All right? And I took the liberty to circle Liberia in green with number 13. And this is 2023 figure. All right? All right. Now, let's try to figure out why are the first 25 richer and why are we poor? Right? Let's try to show some correlations here. Go ahead, just go down. Go back. So I wanted to let the students know a small note on correlation and causality. It's important, you know, for you to understand that those of you who are following the economic relations, international economic relations track is important for you to understand it. The legal people, of course, and the political people is important. So some of the questions I want us to be looking at as we go through these correlates is, does income cause health? If you have more money, are you healthier because you have access to quality health care, or is it vice versa? Right? Is health related to income, good health? Three possibilities. So income causes health. Example, through medical and sanitary expenditures. If you have money to clean the environment so that the people don't sell in filth in Douala or in Pinsville, maybe we will not have more people with typhoid and malaria. That's what he's trying to say. You know, if you live in a clean environment, you're most likely to be healthier. So what causes what? Income causes good health? Come on, let's engage. In this case, what causes what? What is the impact of income on health, and what is the impact of health on income? So another one is health causes income. If you're sick and you can't work, you can't earn, right? But if you're healthy and work is available for you, you will go work. So a healthy person, a healthy population is good for economic growth. Then the common third factor, improved water and sanitation increases both income and health. But how do you get the improved water and sanitation? You have to pay for it. Nothing is cheap. Nothing is free. For those of us who live in the rich world part of the world, you have to pay for everything. You call it bills. And some people complain the bills too much in America. But then in America, it's clean. You have everything works. But here, how many of us really pay the water bill? We don't. We don't pay our bills. So causality problems are really omnipresent. They make papers hard to read for students. And then it is really an identification problem in econometrics for those who have gone that level. Dr. McIntosh here is an economist, so he knows what I'm talking about. So you spend some time to understand causation and causality so that you are able to make rational decisions when you look at growth and economics issue. All right, so let's look at geography, right? So This is a scatter graph. Countries are scattered all over in the graph based on their position from the sun. Right? You see a direct relationship, straight line. All right? Well, then look at the 25 countries we look at, the 25 richest countries. This is Luxembourg, this is USA. All the countries in that 25 group are in the part of the world that is whole. So, and then look at here. All the countries on the second picture you saw, the 25 poorest countries are down here. They are in the tropics. So there seems to be a relationship between geography and economic growth. All right? Just forget about this. Just think about us, where we are, Africa. All the countries came from Africa. We are a hot continent. Could that be the reason why we are poor? Do all the wealthy countries in the world have snow, cool weather? They should be less productive because when it rains here, we don't go to work. The rain actually affects productivity in our country, unless you want to be, you don't want to say the truth. That is why when we were ministers, we used to push public works, so put their plans together in the rainy season and then do the work in the dry season. Because rainy season really is when it rains here ferociously, most people don't go to work. So I wanted to share with you that based on the first 25, the second 25, and where they are located, distance from the sun, latitude matters here. South Africa is richer than most countries in Africa. It's cold there. So geography matters. Next. Life expectancy and income. You see, you know, there's a relationship, but it's curving. So we can conclude that there's a relationship there. So the people in the rich countries, Luxembourg, India, all here, live longer than the countries that are here, African countries. Life expectancy is better here than here. Back to correlation and causality. If your country is wealthier and can afford to clean the environment, to pick up the trash on time, to give you water, the sewage is working, you don't have to worry about all that stuff, that leaking sewage in Monrovia, you know, that has been there for since 1960, we can fix it, then we have all of our population with malaria and typhoid. So there's a relationship there, right? Next. Then fertility. Look. This is the number of children. This is the wealth of the country. GDP, number of children. But because of the, it doesn't mean that you get 40 children, but you get the point, right? For graphing purposes. That's Ethiopia right there. The bomb over there like crazy, right? But look at growth. And we are somewhere here. But when you look at the rich countries, look at growth, less children. Rich people tend to have less children than poorer people. That's what it's trying to say. And when that happens, you can save most of the money and invest in other things. So later on, you will see the 25-year gap between parents and children. This is where it's coming from. All right. Oh,
sorry. Hold it. So you won't step on it.
Yeah. I asked for a laser, you see, so I can see in one place. Because then I gotta get laser pointers. That should not go against me when I come to apply for a teaching job. Yeah. Yeah. All right. No, I'll be careful next time. It's okay.
No.
It's not working?
One back there, you push it towards the wall.
Oh, my man, Elias, is not here today? Elias? Oh, okay. Infant mortality rate and growth. All right, Sierra Leone was the second poorest country in the world, our neighbor, and we are the number 13, but our cousins in Cote d'Ivoire are not on that list. So you'll see the contradiction here. And we are all in the same geography. And we're trying to figure out what Cote d'Ivoire is doing better than we are doing. Is it language? Maybe the French? I don't know. But Niger, Mali, we are all here. Our children die more than the children of the rich people. That's what it's trying to say. Next. Population growth and income. Ah, China was on that list, correct? 25 countries. China was there. But you see China here with us here because of population. They are a rich country, but the way their population is preventing them from reaching their full potential. But they are a superpower, we know that. If they can control fertility in the country, I think they have some policy, they lift their aid, they keep going back and forth. So there is some relationship there. The rich countries are there. They have less children, they have more money. Next. Education and development. Some people said schooling didn't matter in this country for some time, but here's the evidence. We're here, and the rich countries are there. Education matters in the wealth of nations. So those of you who have decided to come here to continue education, this is the right investment. We hope that we can do the same at the elementary level, primary school level, to build the foundations that most of us in this room got before the war compared to today. The schools are lousy. No instructional materials, no school visitations. The entire education system, particularly at the primary level, is littered with volunteer teachers who don't get in-service training and even the curriculum to follow. And nobody holds them accountable because the DEO does not have $800 motorbike to visit the school during the day to sit down in the classroom to supervise the teacher. We lost that, you see, that's why I've been hard on LEC. I told you. LEC gone? Huh? Because we're grumbling. All right. So education matters, all right, before it comes out. So we have that. Our government cannot afford to give DEOs $800 to buy all these motorbikes that the children have, to say, here's your district, here's the motorbike, here's an allowance for fuel, here's the curriculum. Here is some training material. Go and teach the teacher. My first job was that. I was a DEO, as you heard from my intro. I did that for 3 years. And I immerse myself in everything I do. Like, my life depends on them. And so that's how I went to America. I didn't know anybody there. But it was my work with the school system, in the refugee school system, that made IRC to get me to the U.S. as a refugee. I was making $500 a month. I was only, 19, 20 years old. So, that's that. Next. That was for 25 for college graduate students like yourself. There's a correlation. For secondary school, there's also a correlation. Because if you don't finish it, you can't go there. Next, income and urbanization. If you live in Europe and the US, they have big cities, and as you go away from the city, the population tend to be scattered, right? And these cities with the high rises in all of the states in the United States are the growth pool. This is where the investments are. Then agriculture is in the rural parts of the day. Something. They don't allow you to make farm around the city. You know what I'm talking about. So urbanization, planned urbanization, there's a correlation there. Here, we go around and our cities look like shanty towns. I don't say this in a derogatory way, these are just facts. So you can see that when you get more money, you can build a better city. If you don't have the money, you stop with what you have. And it has an effect on how much money you can generate to do the other things. That is why keeping Moruga clean, doing zoning, the city is opening up to Mambacle, to Duazon, and this side on Broville is just wild open. Like the whole country is coming here, but we're not doing anything about zoning. So we live in confusion. It's going to affect our long-term prosperity. That's what it's trying to say. Next. Agriculture and urbanization versus urbanization. You see Liberia there an outlier when it comes to this and that, because we have Monrovia, and then when you go in this corridor, it's Kakata, it's Banda, it's Ganta. Everything else around them is farms, villages. So later on, you will see what Matthews is talking about. When you have an agrarian economy, as if to say it was an 1800 economy versus the 21st century economy, then you have a problem. So, next. Institutions and the level of development. Law enforcement, the courts, the institution that regulate things. There's a direct correlation between institutions and growth. Here are all the countries that are on the poor list. Our institutions are weak. That's what I was trying to say. And is related to our condition. As a poor country, number 13 on that list. Here the portrait is when your brother does wrong, you don't actually impose the law. We don't impose the law when it's on the other side. Somebody comes to me and says, oh, you know, my man, what the, you know, family this and you know that person, but way back in school, you relax the rules, and then you make the, you undermine the institution, you undermine our ability to enforce rules, and then move along this line. That's what we should be pushing, to get out of here. So all of us, we have obligations. When the law says don't do this, don't do it. No begging. All right? We need strong institutions. Next. So, go ahead. So in synthesis, no, no, go back. Yeah, in synthesis, the process of development seems to be related to geography, to demography, to education, to structural transformation, to organization and to institutions. Hopefully I'll get re-invited here and then we can talk about these things separately in future lectures, all right? But that's what I wanted to show you as we go along this conversation, for you to know that countries don't get poor for nothing. You have to know the drivers of growth. And it seems to be like where you live in the world matters. Look at the storm that passed here the other day. Families are struggling, but we are a poor country to intervene. So everybody on your own. Everybody self-contracting. You go take your hosing, you put it there, you can afford it, you go fix it. You are on your own. Survival is the biggest. Right? You gotta change that, people. Most of you here will work in government. Some of you are already in government. If you served in government before, you have the advantage of hindsight. So, any questions? Another question? Yes.
I'm still trying to cripple my mind that the correlation between geography and wealth.
Yeah. Let's go back to the slide. Maybe I can explain it better.
Is it only because it's put in a barrel by
no.
Africa because of the total rich?
No, what that slide is trying to say, when you are poor, you have to go on the ocean. You have no
better off if you have, so they can continue the race. So you are sure they don't. Nobody else? Yes.
Zigzag. It's not stable. You can't depend on it. That's what I was trying to tell you.
because this is my own money. This is money coming from outside. They decide what to give you. They can bring their consultants and do it. They choose a sector they want to put the money in based on their legislature's approval. You don't have control over that. And then this is it. You see that it's going down now. Right? This is the picture. 1960, 2021. Long time of receiving aid. When President Doe became president, this was the highest point in Africa at that time, announced by Ronald Reagan. I was young, but in my research, I saw these things. But then today, it's way here, right? That's why the Americans have a big voice here, because they are the biggest contributor in all of that. So this is ODA plus bilateral. Next.
Now,
yes, go back.
Commissioner Konneh, yeah. On this Universal College Act. In 1960,
go back.
In 1960, when we had a 9.92 million, given our economy size and the amount of our income, where it was around at least 150 million, did we really need the assistance of the 9.92 million at the time?
I think so. Because just look at us today and think, imagine Liberia in 1960. It was in 1960 that we really started to develop the President Tokma. That's why those of us who were around, the elders who saw President Tokma govern this country, will tell you that it was Tokma who paved the Nairobi streets. And then he opened the interior. Those things were not there. Previously, everybody would go in the house. So when Firestone came, and the pressure was on to help Nigeria, then aid was introduced to USAID and all those people coming in to help the Peace Corps to civilize, right? Don't forget, we're the only country that was founded by an NGO, the American Colonization Society. Build the first modern state in Africa and to spread Christianity. That was it. That was the mission. From civics, way back. Aha. So, yeah, I think so. But the question should be, was it properly utilized? As it should be for all of this, during my tenure and all of that. That's what I'll try to show based on experience. Yes, sir.
All right, I'm in Richard. Former instructor in all universities.
Okay.
My interest here,
yeah.
In 1960,
yes.
Liberia was small.
Yes.
An addition made to Liberia after 1965. Small population, easy to manage. But the managers of the day were most selfish. Because they created a gap between them and us. If that gap could be removed at that time, and we had our way with what we had, with the number of the population then, I do believe we're never going to be well out. The growth was going to start that day, but the growth stopped that day. So the management mismanaged what they had.
Yeah, I'm listening.
All right.
So, I hear you. That was on the inside. The managers you're talking about, this is how they perform. This is Liberia's. This is our journey. This graph was the first started with Dr. McIntosh and stopped at 2008. I guess I love it. So every year I keep hiring. So I'm here now. Every year, as soon as they announce the estimated growth model, I update my spreadsheet. But this is a fascinating story. It's good for all of you to understand this.
this journey. This is our growth, the wealth, all that thing we're talking about. While we are number 13 on our list, this is it, in summary. 1960. You see, Turban year was, in economic terms, whether it was distributed evenly, that's a whole different question. But in terms of growth and income per capita, the population was smaller, investments were coming in, open door policy, all this stuff coming in, all of that. You see, we were on a trajectory until 1972, 1 year after he died. Let's talk about that, because we'll go through each president. What do you think happened? Here we have impressive growth. I'm not supporting Turban policy, right? I know you were concentrated among the few. So it comes to your point, the foundation probably was crooked. If we had invested most of the money back then and fixed the institutions and include other Liberians in the governance process, we would not have gotten to this point under President Turban when Liberians started to agitate for inclusion and it led to what? To a coup. Plus, factors beyond the country's control, exogenous factor, the rubber price went down, the oil price went up. President Turban was not present. I'm just telling you. So 1972, you see here, he's struggling. Zigzag, volatile, period. It went down, it went up. More people coming to Monrovia, more people born in, population is happening. And less people are farming to feed themselves when they were doing that under President Turban. And then you announce a price policy, and there's a political group putting pressure, say, oh no, that's too much, we can bring a rice at a cheaper price. This is the late Honorable Barkus Matthews and his Progressive Alliance of Liberia, right? So in 1980, the president is killed in the mansion in front of his wife and grandchildren, right there. That's why nobody sleeps there. So this is 1980 right here. Look at this. 1990. From 1980 to 1990, it erased all of this. Institutions. Because the truly party hegemony had concentrated power just among themselves. When you hear some of us speaking that the county should be involved in the government, it's not because the counties don't have capacity, they don't have competent people. This is the history we're talking here, guys. Any leader of this country who wants to survive in office and do well, you have to include everybody, because there's a history here of agitation when you exclude other people. It's part of our culture. It's not religion.
Is the real Liberia. They hold on to the tradition, the culture. That Liberia that was intended to be civilized still exists, but they are smaller. they're aging. They're the ones now doing the farm, because the younger group that I will talk about, group number three, they've all left. They are motorbike riders, they are keke riders, and then when they don't succeed there, they turn to cooch and alcohol. We have an existential threat in our country, human capacity. My brother, you were asking a question about capacity building. You have to have the foundation for you to. So the second group is our group here, educated men and women, but we're very selfish. We don't want to be, to succeed in our careers, our family, just our cars, our house. That's it, just us. And then we get into the political field, we get home money, and then we forget to be at that first group that is hoping that our city and children is here. We, and then the last group is the most, is the biggest group. The volatile library is young men, girls, young girls. The biggest part of our population, right? And they're the ones who are supposed to be the future. But they are the most vulnerable. So, the demagogue will come out one day, the coach set up, and appeal to them, because he's like them. And they will vote for the drug dealer, and he will just give them drugs to keep them with him. That's what I said, one day we could wake up here and get a coach, boys as leaders, until we, in the smart Liberian class, can connect the two. That's what we need to do. So here is I just want to show you something. So you go back. So you see here, this is a big valley here. A long time in the valley. The war years. The war years. There was no way Mr. Taylor was able to jump here. So now here we are not even at Martin Sanger 2 level here. Through the effort of Dr. McIntosh, Dr. JJ, everybody else had the opportunity to be decision makers in post-conflict Liberia, contributed to this. But at the same time, Ebola, at the same time, COVID, we don't know what will come next year. Look at Ukraine and the Russian, yeah? Look at Gaza and Israel. There's something happening always. And when it happens, what fish do we have to fry in Russian in a frigid zone, in a geographic part of the world that's supposed to be richer? Well, it affects us here, in the tropic zone. Something's wrong. So the decisions we make going forward is, as I was saying earlier on, is to keep pushing this. We gotta keep pushing this until we reach this 1972 level, where income per capita, if you took the country's entire money, you divide it among the population, everybody will get about $840. Right? Still small, but we'll have to do the work to get there. And you will see later how long it will take us to double our growth, our income. You can go back. I just want to show this so you see there's something there. So I extracted the post-conflict period so you can see. If you go back. Okay, this period here, 2005, right here to here is what you're gonna see here. Then, okay? All the official development assistance, bilateral and multilateral, this is it, right here. From 2006, 2022. Yes.
Yes, I have another question. So, with our strong system,
huh?
I'm saying with our very strong country system,
yes.
Is it possible that we can get better outcome from ODA?
Yes. I'll show you later on.
And what are those countries that actually practice that are doing better?
Certainly, not the countries among the 25 poorest countries.
I didn't go that far. That's an assignment for the class. Yes.
When are you in the discussion? You talk about the geography, you talk about culture, and you talk about demography as major factors of development in Europe. Okay. However, you can see Mexico is a neighbor to the United States of America.
Yes.
Indonesia is a neighbor to Singapore.
Yes.
Yemen is not too far from Qatar.
Yes.
And there is a big gap between these countries. Qatar is the third richest country on earth.
Yeah.
And Yemen is one of the poorest.
Yeah.
Can we say that demography, geography, and other factors are not solely responsible for the growth and development? Because there's a book, you may know, Why Nations Fail. The authors concluded that inclusive political and economic institutions lead to prosperity and development, while extractive institutions lead to poverty. And evidently, our former president, Madam Kennedy, she was once asked in Addis Ababa, you know, referring to Liberia as a poor country, she said, no, we are not poor. Rather, we are poorly managed. Can we say that management is matter rather than culture, geography, demographics, and all of that?
Institution certainly is the strongest correlate there. But I'm trying to introduce your student to correlation and causation. When you look at all of the countries on the second picture I show you, they have lousy institutions. They are in the tropics, they have plenty of population, their cities are scattered. So our job as researchers is to say which one should we relax to improve this one, to improve that one. And certainly in this case, institutions is the strongest one to relax. The best one institution. That comes to the issue of managers. Yes.
Senator, I know that there are challenges as it relates to Liberia effectively utilizing the official development systems. So I would actually like to know what are some of those challenges associated with Liberia utilizing the official development systems effectively and specifically when it comes to infrastructure.
We'll come there. So I just want to show you a preview of how we're spending ODA in Liberia, right? So the biggest donor, US, the World Bank, IMF, EU, Sweden, Germany, AFDB, Global Fund, which is the big trust fund for health, and then Japan, and then the IFA, agriculture. And this is how we spend our money, all right? About 14% into education. The biggest portion is going to health. And 27% into other social interventions. And look at this, only 5% into productive activities. That speaks to why the ODA picture you saw is not really giving us this. Because few of them going into productive that should enhance growth and expand the economic possibility frontier. So we put everything into poverty reduction through health education. Okay? This is how Liberia has been spending in there. So the challenge, coming to your question there. So between 1960 and 2021, we received here about $11.7 billion in aid from outside of the country. We can ask ourselves about the impact. So there's no clear relationship between aid and growth. As you saw from the two graphs, the first one, ODA, and then the growth, the period where we had the most growth was before the war, after the war. So, and the picture is mixed, as I'll show you later. So the question is foreign assistance a resource or a management issue? Institution. Certainly in this case, it's not a resource issue. It is a management issue. Jeffrey Sachs, you know him, big opponent of the MDGs, said that foreign aid is a garden hose. Then he, at the UN, he said the world needed a fire hose to fight poverty around the world. But what we need really is knowledgeable, committed, and strong firefighters, institutions, management. You can't take a novice who is good at political battleground and put them in charge of institutions that's supposed to create wealth for the country. You can't do that. Yes, you can't do that. You need people with the requisite training, those who have mustered the courage to come and be disciplined by sitting here for an hour and a half, 3 times a week, and going home and completing assignment and coming back, that discipline. It's that discipline that takes you into an office, and then you'll be able to sit down there and actually think through the solution for your sector. Yes? What? Let me come closer. I can't hear you.
Shipping. Nobody knows how much they're declaring. Every year they declare losses for their shipping. You can't be in a business where every year you're not getting revenue, but you're still in the same business. That's, something's wrong with that. So I just want to come back for the sake of time that in all of the correlates, institution is the key. The quality of people we put in these institutions and the way we hold them accountable to deliver is the key for us here. And clearly, it doesn't exist. You first. Okay. You. Yeah.
By President Dutton, and he set up what was called SCOGO, Special Commission on Government Operation.
Ah.
And there were a number of outcomes from that commission. Number one, they started to establish a Liberia Institute of Public Administration, to establish the General Accounting Commission, to establish GSA and a couple of other entities to help to, you know, safeguard in a budgetary framework how government should operate. In fact, I was the 27th person who was recruited to go to America for graduate studies to come and help train Liberians to be proper managers. I came back home 1980 Christmas Day.
Ah.
I left America 1980. And my first assignment was to go that week. I started work on the 2nd of January to go to San Nicolas to deliver a paper on effective utilization of staff for productivity or whatever.
Yeah.
But LIPA had the first superintendent's conference, the military superintendents, and what a mess it was. All the superintendents were military officers, and they all came to a seminar in San Nicolas with their handbags and a bottle of gin and a walkie-talkie.
those were the managers of, you know,
there you go.
That's the cost of
it. All right. And my whole life as a teacher from 1981, I've been dedicated to teaching public administration. And my last big assignment was to assist in the implementation of the decentralization program. So we started creating the county service centers.
Around, yes.
The county service centers. You heard about them, right?
Yeah.
They have collapsed.
All collapsed.
All was collapsed. Because government cannot maintain the operations to be able to carry services to the people in Nigeria. So how will both happen?
Good. Thank you, Doc. Yeah, then we proceed. We still got more to go. I don't want to. Yes.
Okay. I have an issue with my professor, Lies in that Singapore versus Liberia.
Mm-hmm.
In 1960, lies in Liberia made tremendous progress for knowledge in terms of sustained economic development. Then Singapore in 1960, and today Singapore have surpassed us in terms of making significant indicators of sustainable development. I want to know what my problem is. It's that we as Liberians, we need a functional, effective, efficient system that works for all.
Okay.
That system that seems to spread development if it's not coming back a political way or intervention. So I want to know whether our laptop is going to be lacking system, a functional system.
Yeah. Okay, let's do it this way. Let me go through the lecture. Then we have, just take your questions. We have Q&A. And then we'll go from there. Then I will start to address your questions. So we are getting there. So we are looking at the endogenous internal versus the external development. All right. So I encourage you to look for this book. Maybe you can go online and read the summary. It's called Descent on Development. It was published in 1971, the year I was born. But it's still very relevant today. You know. And there, Peter Bauer is trying to tell us that aid represents aid. Just defining aid, what is aid? The importation of resources not generated within the receiving economy. That's aid. Any money you get from somebody else that was not generated in your economy, except for the investment, FDI, is aid. So you talk about skills. There are skills that generated that money somewhere. Those skills most likely cannot be here available to use the resources when it is provided. So we need capacity building is important. And then he talks about external money tend to bias development process in directions based on external prototypes, which are often inappropriate and therefore more damaging, as we saw from the graph. Next. So he continued with this. So I'll print this and give it to you. I don't want to read to you. So it's just to buttress the graph from 1960 to 2021 on the ODA part. So these are some of the reasons why maybe our case was not effective. Capacity, political will, institutions, all the things that should make it work are not present here. And we are not investing for them to be here, and aid is going down. So we're going to be on our own. We have to focus on growing this economy, fixing it, by focusing on institutions, by focusing on the growth-enhancing sector, you can be programmed to accept mediocrity. Because you're used to sleeping in heat, so therefore you have accepted it. You used to just come in to work or school at 9 o'clock, 5 o'clock you go home, or you stop at some beer shop, you drink, and then you go home, that's your day. No, there should be a second shift. In Kenya, Nairobi, when I used to get up to go on mission, I'm going to catch my flight at 4 a.m. Kenyans are walking in this small group to the next factory.
Yes. Those who live there, you know what I'm talking about. The Matotos are, you know, busy during that time. They are jam-packed. But people are walking to go to work.
In Kenya, the biggest economy in East Africa. I'm just saying, we can't accept what's happening with the electricity situation because it's going to fuel the economy. That's why it's important. Or else we go to bed at 9, everything shuts down by midnight. Then from midnight to 9 o'clock is unproductive. Nothing happens in our country. And so we expect the government to do everything. Next, to provide the jobs. Okay, now let's get to the financing issue of official development assistance, right? So we have a dual budget problem. What do I mean by this? We have the country budget, then we have the ODA budget. Whenever we debate the budget, we are debating what we generate domestically. We don't call public hearings on the all that $11.7 billion. Not one day we ever had public hearing. And so the central financial management task is the management of fixed recurrent cost. Debt, wages, and most of that are proposed poverty reducing expenditures. They are fixed and recurrent in nature. Civil servants, teachers, health, worker salaries, so and so forth. We hear proposed, this is it. That's the focus. Let's just pay the people, then we're doing good. Nothing else. And then, you know, this is our dilemma, right? So ODA is imprudent to finance long-term liabilities with volatile external funding, as you saw in the zigzag. It's very volatile. So you can depend on it long-term, whether it is grant or loan. So basically, the solution is to focus on domestic financing. That's why we created the LRA. It was Dr. McIntosh and Dr. Sayer. They pushed that before they left to go to Washington, and we just made it happen. That's why you have the LRA. But is the LRA efficient as an institution? Are there gaps? Lose money somewhere in the economy? Can they be robust? But at the same time, revenue is a function of growth. That is why growth is important. We have to invest in the growth sectors. Next. So then there's something called the government reaction function, right? Just like we too react when we see new money. The question is, how do government react to an additional resource to the country and in the hands of the government? What do you think about in terms of revenue, in terms of expenditure, in terms of institutions, in terms of the creation of additional liabilities? How do we look at the budgetary impact of new resources? What other reaction can we identify? We can talk about this in Q&A. I'm asking you based on this. When you get new money, what comes to mind? Do you invest to increase it? Or do you spend it on cars that depreciate? Or clothes that after you wear it one time, you don't want it again? You know, this is both a personal and a public problem, because we take our behaviors into public. Next. So let's do the matching revenue to expenditure. Different types of revenues are suited to different types of expenditure. So here we have the consolidated, all the money goes there. And the money is fungible. The first to call on that money in the consolidated account is the first to get the money. Whether that money is going to do growth enhancing or something, it's gone. So we need to start thinking about matching revenue to certain expenditures and timing, just like the way the non-discretionary recurrent expenditures are. Borrow revenue finance capital expenditure. The BFM law is very solid. When you take loan on behalf of the country, you have to do the studies to know the economic return of that project. The law is clear. You can't borrow money to pay wages. You borrow to invest in a sector that is going to expand the economy. But all of that, hopefully we can see them work again. Fees and charges cover specific expenditures to which they can be directly related. So we have LRA. There are so many fees. We're charging user fees in the port. There's a contract between the service provider and the LRA, and the portion of the government goes to the LRA versus the consolidated or tied to specific revenue generation activity. That's the truth. Right? So the cost of doing business is way up. All the business people complaining. You're paying more to stay alive. So the key question is, what activities are appropriately financed by foreign aid? To answer your question, these are some of the questions that we, the policymakers, need to be asking. What are you doing with $189 million below the line in the budget, particularly in this budget? Who is giving what and for what? Can we see the projects? Are they paying consultants? Are the consultants endogenous or exogenous? And the consultants leaving knowledge there, is that person protected so that when the consultant goes and there's a turnover in the political system, they don't keep that person out? So many things. So to overcome the dual budget problem, ODA needs to be less volatile. Meaning that you should negotiate long-term financing for 5 to 7 years versus the 3 year thing that we have. At the negotiation table, this is what we should be pushing for. And we can't put this in law because they too have their rules. We need to make expenditure financed by FBA more flexible. They put money in trust fund and they spend from there. So if there's an emergency on an economic infrastructure somewhere else, there's no flexibility since money is supposed to be fungible to fix that binding constraint, relax it so that the economy people say, no, it's going to be here. Then you got to take 1 whole year to contract, and you don't want to fix it. For example, LAC, full turbines, one crashed in 2021 because they were overrunning it. Since 2021, it was not serving. Why? Because there's no money. Meanwhile, we are signing the financing agreement with the World Bank, not to fix that and relax that constraint, but to do solo planning. So with the climate, with the geography, with the water table going down, with one turbine down, you can only run one turbine at half a day. Three turbine machines in Bushra Island was built with the concept of bone mines pre-war because dry season, bone mines would supply LEC electricity and Monrovia would be alive. Those of us who were here know that. Same concept. So bone mine is not here anymore. Let's create that on LEC. So two of them crashed because of poor maintenance. So with one turbine down to two turbine, generators down, you have this. But they say when the rain comes, we'll get electricity. So, I'm just trying to use our current situation so you understand about the flexibility of expenditure in foreign systems. It's a straight line. You got to do it this way. Once you sign the agreement, the recipient country does not have the flexibility to amend the financing agreement, to get board approval, to
see if we can address that, since that's more important for the economy than the roads that will come next year. As an example. So they do have their roads, we have ours here, but if we are going to make progress, we have to relax this and create something. So, and the flexibility can also be, instead of having consultants or people that come from abroad for the entire life of the USAID does, they bring, they contract people from Washington, they bring them, and they're here for the life of the project. On the project end, they go to the project down. So can we make them short term and bring Liberians in, and then they can take over, and then while they are implementing the 5 to 7 year project, the government is preparing to keep it going. Because it's important to address all the issues that we saw. And next. So, most of you, all of you have talked about the effectiveness of ODA. So I try to share that we have different dimensions, right? There's a political dimension. The country's strategic foreign policy. This is the political piece of international relations. It's not strong. What do you call it? Is it defined? Are we going after aid or are we going after the private sector in our relationships with the nation? What is this for? When we focus our attention on attracting FDI, which is needed. But to bring FDI, you need to fix the institution, the regulatory institution, the corruption, the code, so that people don't come here. And then economic. What is the macroeconomic objective of the government? What is your strategy for growth? Because growth is what we want. Our economy is maybe 5.3 to 5.5 million. Smaller than Sierra Leone. Definitely smaller than Guinea. Most definitely smaller than Guinea. But our border control, our artificial borders that were created by colonialism is a constraint. From here to the border of Uruguay in the 1950s, 1960s, checkpoint. Right? So it constrains commerce. It's not friendly to strangers. And the strangers most likely are the ones with money, particularly from the wealthier country in the non-Liberian world. Monkeys and pigs in the forest. Monkeys tend to jump to the fruitier part of the forest. In our forest, MRU, the fruitiest country is Côte d'Ivoire. We should have an economic consulate there to try to figure out how the Ivorians are doing their private sector, because it's working for them. You're talking about how many billion-dollar budget? 10, 15? President Ouattara announced that a few weeks ago. Billions! So, the Marshall Plan. In his opening statement, Dr. Sumaworo talked about the Marshall Plan. DMR said they didn't talk about this. But the Marshall Plan was explicitly related to the private sector when the United States decided to intervene in Western Europe after the war. They targeted the private sector to address the foreign exchange issue there, and then they used the growth to take care of the social services, as you see here. But today, the primary impetus for foreign assistance is social investment to improve welfare, the clinics, the hospitals, the schools. We depend on other countries' taxpayers' money to educate. But when the intervention was made in Europe, the focus was on the private sector and the social objectives were achieved through growth. And that's the way to do it. Somebody was asking a question earlier. We need to start thinking that way. Agriculture cannot survive on $5 million investment by the government. Yes, our economy is still Marcusian,
But to go from there, we have to fix the land rights issue, and we have to make the investments, the incentives, be bold and go borrow and create and reopen the agriculture bank and put good people there to lend to farmers and make our foreign policy with China about agriculture. They are feeding 1.1 billion people. You go there, they are planting cabbage and onions and everything in the air. Have you seen that in China? They have these layers and layers, the water is running, and there is oxygen in the water, same oxygen in the soil that supply that to the crops and the growers up there to feed their people. There's no hunger there. You've never heard that Chinese people are dying of hunger. They do. So maybe we need to say, China, forget about all these buildings. We appreciate them. I don't like the architecture in a way. But we accept anything. So bureaucratic. How about the interests of those who are giving us the money? What is their strategic interest in our country? Are we asking that question before we say yes? Let me go further. Our oldest partner, we call them the traditional partner, is the United States. In the Cold War, their strategic interest here was to spy on the rest of on Russia from here. So that's what happened from the Omega station. And American people have Omega there. It was a satellite station there where I was transmitted to Congo. Democratic Republic of Congo. And Mobutu was there. And then we spy on Russia to get information on the geopolitics of the Cold War. America had been when the Berlin Wall collapsed, that Israel was gone, and our leaders were not quick enough based on the second draft that you saw, President Obama's conference. They didn't move quick enough at the time when they didn't move both to the U.S. And successive administrations have now tried to revisit our strategic engagement with the U.S. based on why can't America help us have a Marshall Plan type of national relationship to move the country forward? Maybe we need to scare them. And the way to scare them is we see the Russians and the Chinese building gold processing plant in Mali and Burkina there. So we signal that we want the same thing here from those guys. And maybe we'll force them to the table to negotiate. But the relationship is not working. A lot of money come in and they bring their people to run the programs. And I don't know who will go steal American people money and make a lot of noise like they did with the hospital in Magibi. And the ambassador was here every day, kept calling people out. So we can't have that happen. We have to relook at our something. And of course, financial. It's a financing decision. That's cool. We'll see what the financial is. So different people get different views, eh? And I thought this was an interesting something here. If you get three economists in a room, you will get three different opinions about anything. Unless you have Lord Keynes, and then you have four. And then maybe Dr. McIntosh will have five. Economists think, you know, they see things differently. It's hard for two economists to agree on how things should work. So next. So in summary, the question is, does ODA work? Studies show a positive effect on growth of per capita income in terms of it working, because it helps to relax certain things. As you see here, when you have growth, ODA, you can do other things and use your domestic money to pay your debt. So it removes some pressure from your budget. Is it effective? No. As we saw from the graph. Why? because of bad investment decisions. This is the financing issue. The recipient government's macroeconomic objective, and you will agree with me, for us, is driven by the public sector versus the private sector. So all the money that comes from outside, we dump it in the public sector, thinking that the government will grow the economy. Because you have the development bureaucracies, delayed payments, corruption issues, recipient country taking donor money without their acquiescence. It's a positive, yes, it allows you to take care of your debt, because you have to service the debt. But the question is, what are you spending the debt on? So in conclusion, ODA as a financing decision works, but ODA as an investment decision is often ineffective. The policy challenge is to have a sound macroeconomic policy, a growth strategy, where you want to put the money, and stick to it. Next. So yeah, we've seen this, saw this. So I just wanted to go back. So I'm not going to go through this, but it's good for you to see it before we go. I just want you to focus on the value, that huge value we went in. Most of us in this room are in this generation here. So the burden now is on us to change this. The Singapore, the this, the that. It's us. It took a young Lee Kuan Yew to do it with his friends. So it means when your friends does wrong, you tell them. People say, I had a personal issue with LEC, CEO, no. No, it's a former colleague. We work together on the MCC and all of that. I mean, you were in the cabinet. I don't care about politics. Former finance minister, him, I recruited them to help their country on the Millennium Challenge Compact, and they deliver under my supervision. So we have to push our friends to deliver. If they are not doing it, it's not personal. We're doing it for our country, or else we're stuck. All right, next. So what is development, really? Development. Somebody go post more, Palau or somewhere, it's a development. What is development? So it's the expansion of human capabilities. It involves education, health, freedom, security, standard of living. And most of these things require resources. They're not free. Right? So one variable to look at in the development debate is GDP or the country's output. And when you divide that by the population, the income, the output. That's how economists, Dr. Mackenzie will tell you, measure the wealth of countries. That's how we got on that list, the poorest list. And that's how the richest country got on the richest list. You have to increase your country's output. Output can be used to consume, to educate, to cure, to protect, to build infrastructure. That's what we want. This is where we want to be. Whoever asked that question, what do we want to be? We want to be able to do all these things with our own money. I hear speakers in Liberia say the country is rich. No, we're not rich. Any wealth that you cannot touch and invest it to improve your life, what kind of wealth is that? Exactly. So, Wolo Gizi is there, but it's a wealth. Unless we exploit it and use it sensibly to address all this issue, it is no use to the country. But look at the distance from the sea, geography. Even if we were to extract it, this town will get We got sent, we got good people. We now learn from our from Danco, from Burma, from Western Rostov, from B Mountain, from all these things that we're making noise from. We continue learning from all of that now. We've really done everything, but it's there. Big deposit. But from Lofa to the free port, it's too much. What good is it to the public? Unless you find somebody with money who will not exploit you, just like they exploited other people to do it. So development is an interesting thing. So that is why we are interested in the level of in the level improved output income per capita across Liberia. Thanks. So growth accumulates over time. It doesn't happen overnight. It doesn't happen for government change. It gotta be deliberate, intentional policies that stick. And there's the rule of 69, the time to double your economy. So you take 69 divided by your growth rate. Alright, it's a formula that economists use to determine when we how many years it will take for the country to double its growth numbers. So we care about our children. Traditionally parents are 25 years older than their children, right? I mean not today, but you get the idea.
See, these guys, that's what they do. The children live with them up to college, to go to college, and the children struggle to get out of the nest. And they stay there on the environment. I think you're supposed to have a girlfriend, or you get married, or you have a child. So that's 24 generations, 25 years, right? That's the definition of the media generation is a 25-year gap. So traditionally, parents are 25 years older than their children and should be wealthier than their children. Can we see that?
So, next. So here, I'm trying to show this. Why is growth important? So here are selected growth rates from 0.5% GDP growth. When you hear some of us talk about growth. But it's all that growth will eat, yes, that growth will eat. You need to grow to create wealth. And of course, not in the absence of institutions, of sound managers, and all of that. That is why the job of the leader of this country is very tough. It's very hard. So when you grow at 0.5%, it will take you 138 years to double that zero, the size of the economy. The parents are just only one time richer than their children. Everybody equal. The child doesn't respect the father or the mother anymore because you're not doing anything for them. You got no leverage with the child. The grandparents and the children relationship is 1.3. So 1%, 69 years. We are expected to grow at 4.6% this year. I'll round it up to 5%. We have to sustain the 5% growth to double the size of this particular economy this year in 13 years. That's what it means. Right? Parents at that time will be 3.5% wealthier. It's insignificant. Grandparents, poor. But where are they? They die because of the mortality rate. They don't live long. Why? Because no good healthcare. Again, the correlates. Remember the correlates? Aha. Uh-huh. Making sense to you now? So the idea is to push your growth higher. It doesn't happen. When you grow at 8%, you're talking about 8.6%. Look, the parents begin to get money. We, in the 25, this generation now, we are 25 years older than our children. Right? And then in the rich countries that you saw, the grandparents are 55 times. That is why they save money for their grandchildren college education. That pressure is not on their father. Most of them. They retire, they get social security money, they get 401k, they get this, they get brokerage, they get that. That's how they do it. When they die, the children don't fight over property there. It goes to charity. Lala. It goes to charity, a foundation for their cause. So we must be interested in growth. We must take the little money we have and put it, put some of them and invest some of them in the growth enhancing sector. So next year we'll begin to see the numbers increase. Yes, we should pay our people. It will go through the circular flow. The workers will go to businesses, businesses will sell, they will pay taxes, but it's the same loop, the same businesses, the same actors. We have to push the frontier. And that frontier includes trade. And instead of imagining trade with America and China, we can do trade with Cote d'Ivoire, with Guinea, by increasing our economic boundaries beyond the artificial boundary laid down by colonial, you know, politics, since we are all cousins anyway. We should invest along the borders to make crossing borders and trade easier for the citizens of the Mano River Union. Yes, ma'am. Yeah. I mean, Q&A when I come. Yeah? So is Liberia stuck in the Malthusian equilibrium? What is it? Malthusian. Low productivity growth. If you have low productivity growth, you are in a Malthusian economy. And when you have low productivity, you got low GDP. You depend on subsistence income. You have high fertility. You have high mortality. You have low education. You have lousy institutions. You have large gender gaps. So the rich have more surviving children than the poor. But what we saw there in the corridor. So average income was stagnant. There was significant social downward mobility in the poor country. Next. What we need is modern growth. And modern growth started in the 18th century. Fertility collapses. We are growing, we are burning at 2.1%. Our economy is growing between 3 to 4%. You tell me, man. Tell me, money more than we're growing. And so it's a big issue. I mean, how do we stop money? How do you tell somebody don't want to go forward? It's hard. So we have to let money grow. Electricity fuels, no, sorry, education explodes. In the rich countries, money grows, fertility goes down, education explodes, you have a well-educated country, electricity, all the developed countries, stable, and the fuel production. It started with the Industrial Revolution. But then today, technological improvement accelerates. Why can't we make a road to Canada a tech hub and bring Apple, Microsoft, and say, come and operate here tax-free? Because the utility to the economy is education explosion, technological advancement. Data is teaching accounting and to raise power. Malthusian. We have to change it. There's electricity there in that corridor. 5G network is in that corridor. A paved road is there. All the infrastructure that should ignite growth. There. What is missing is the idea and the leadership. For BWR should be different now. Jakarta should be a different city. And then GDP takes off, fewer people depend on government. So that's some of the lecture. The great divergence in economic, in income per capita is related to different timing and speed of the transition out of the Malthusian equilibrium. So the transition from that equilibrium to modern growth involved changes in technological progress, fertility, schooling, gender roles, and urbanization, as we saw from the correlates. So we don't know exactly what triggers the changes. I refer you to these readings. I guess some pointers there. But for us as a country, we are still stuck in Malthusian, pre-18th century economic model. So we have to change that as a country. Next. So start looking at your country in these dimensions. That would be my advice to you as the dimension I gave you. Thank you.
That's where you're going now is what you call growth diagnostics.
You have to diagnose your economy to identify the constraints. You have multiple constraints, then you find the most binding.
Yeah.
Then you binding one, binding two, you relax it, this will happen.
You can priority get on the damage that have been caused in time past.
We'll do that later some other time. Yes, sir.
So the protocol was only two questions.
Okay, last question. Yeah. Then that's all.
Thank you, sir. Fantastic question. I want to I am happy to be in this room, listening to you talk about, the presentation in a way that is mind open. I mean, these different theories, as my colleague said, the Obama growth theory, all the different theories, have been available for many years now. My own confusion is why Liberia has not choosing to use some of the theory to take us from one step to another.
You want the honest answer? Because our leaders are insecure. They are afraid of people who can do it. And they keep them out. That's it. They would rather have people run these institutions that cannot challenge them. Why should you be afraid of your president? Why? Why are people so afraid of president here? Why are people afraid of president here?
So a finally carved of phraseology, what's wrong with us is us. And the basis of that was that he thought that Liberians needed to go through a psychological revolution, in order to enhance the thinking processes as a way of dealing with the developmental dimensions and dilemmas that were encountering. And in my old life, after traveling to more than 50 countries, I have that belief, that what is wrong with us is us.
Yes.
And I really didn't see poverty until I went to India in 1984. If you go to India, I'm not saying the riches are not there, right? The riches are so. But if you want to see real human degradation, you will see it in India also. And we are just we're 5 million here, and they passed a billion already. They're a billion, I think, 0.4, 0.5, they were taking in China. So that psychological transformation has to happen. We have to go through that psychological transformation. And as leaders, perhaps we need to sacrifice a little to lead a psychological transformation process. That's just what I wanted to say.
Thank you. Thank you, Dad. So, 2015, I went to India to negotiate a $188 million loan to extend our electricity grid. We're bringing the electricity in from Cote d'Ivoire, the transport CLSG. And it was coming into Yekepa, Danta, and then it ricocheted into Guinea, through JK, Missouri Bureau, continued down to Buchanan, and then came all the way to Buchanan Highway, connect with the LAC grid around Perrysburg, and then it's part of the grid, and it goes through Bomi, Cape Mount. So
In my head, we did this big study with that soil in Suarez, the National Vision Exercise. I mean, that Baron Tower. That was done. Tell us about that. At the GC. I learned so much from them. So much. I mean, professionally, I also learned a lot about my country's governance history just by hanging around. That document is laying down. Knowledge, you know, what you're saying is there. So, our government came and said, no, we don't need that. The GC became a shell. Institutions, right? So I go to India, I do my analysis, we have a triangle here. The population census, the first one since 1984, was overseen by Dr. McIntosh in this room. So this was our latest that Dr. JJ and I were helping them when I was minister, and he was minister of finance. So that census told us that the majority of the population lived from Monrovia to Danta, from Monrovia to Buchanan. And then when you connect the rail to Yankee Park, that's a triangle right there, correct? Very good. That's a growth triangle for Liberia. Even today, majority of the people live there. So the work we tried to do was to put the infrastructure in. On balance growth, target one area, and then you go to the other area. That was the primary growth identified in the PRS. Majority of the people, this census is important. So we did the Buchanan Road, we did the road from here to Danta, we brought electricity in. But this electricity was going to Buchanan and then to Monrovia, and then leaving one side of the triangle out, the hypotenuse. The hypotenuse in this triangle is to Danta. The base is from here to Buchanan. And then how you call the other line? The rail, those, anyway, you get the idea. So we said, we'll put the roads in, then we put the electricity in. So we went to India to negotiate 188 to bring the line from Danta to Banga. I think you can see it now. And then you can see small wire going from Kakata to Banga. That gap, that's the money that this government needs to raise. And finish that and complete that corridor. So you get the paved road, you get the electricity, you get the 3G. You tell the mobile companies, we have the high-speed internet under the sea. When we went down that day, everybody was out of internet. We brought it in 2010, 2011, the ACE cable. No, national security, I can't tell you where. They're going to pay me for that. But it comes from the ground somewhere and go to the table, and then it goes up, and then it broadcasts, and then there's a consortium of the mobile company that subscribe to it, that have that internet. From 2G to 3G and then to 4G and 5G in some cases. It's important. So you put that there. So I go to India from the hotel, from the airport at night to the hotel, see all these keke, the bajar, plenty in the place. I said, my first time there. In the morning, we're going to negotiate now at the foreign ministry. Our relationship with India is the foreign ministry. I swear to God, I go to the place I saw poverty worse than West Point. In India, I see people cooking on the street. They cooking on the street, major street. The children coming to beg you for money. I went into that negotiation, to be honest, that reluctant to negotiate with that country for Vietnam. It became a moral question for me. Because the poverty I saw there, I thank God that here was better. If I came back, I went with, of course, Sumaworo, who was the chair of the Ways and Means. I went with Foreign Ministry, Brisbane, who were there together. So they said, we see it. I said, well, I'm having a conflict now. Should we really take money from this country? Or religious person. So I don't put on my face. So I come home, go. Before my colleagues, I went to the president and said, I'm going to disagree on this. So what happened? He said, the property I saw there, he said, moral, I'm going to take money from you. President said, he was shocked. He said,
What do you care about that? Go get the money from the bank.
I don't want to share that story before this lecture. Sometimes in this world, there's a moral dilemma. And then the choice is between your morality and your country. And in this case, more country. It's been a pleasure to talk to you. Thank you for giving the opportunity.
Thank you so much. Okay, just for quick announcement before we conclude. Group photos, but then this will be it. The first photo taking will be with the honorable men and the faculty.